I started as an architectural historian. I was just very excited with New York townhouses, and although I lived in New England, and little did I know that some years later I would end up getting to have the opportunity to work on, you know, some of the most magnificent interiors in New York. What we do at EverGreene is deal with all the kinds of the interior architectural arts, three-dimensional ornament, two-dimensional flat wall surfaces and ceilings, as well as wall coverings, and every possible type of decorative painting. We have about 220 people around the country, including project managers, architectural conservators, painting conservators, plaster craftsmen, decorative painters of the decorative arts. So I can assure you those crafts are still alive today. And many of the craftsmen come globally to New York. That's one of the great benefits of being here, that we can draw on people with expertise from all around the world with really quite amazing skills. Starting off with looking at your building, looking at its bones, what gives its unique character? Proportions of the spaces, the style of the details, the key elements, the plaster, the woodwork, the moldings, the door panels, what identifies it from a particular place in time, and understanding that as the core from the beginning. Sometimes just starting with a raw space and then taking the time to really look, explore, and appreciate what it has as a starting point to work with. The bones of the building will include, of course, the structure, the timbers, the wood beams, the plaster. Sometimes you encounter things that have really been through rough periods, yet they can have hidden clues. What we do in, you know, larger buildings is really map the conditions with conservators, sound the ceilings, look for hidden delamination, instabilities. This process of kind of diagnosing, documenting, identifying the ranges of treatments to repair them, and quantifying it is the foundation of, you know, an accurate budget for plaster repair. And of course, that's the foundation of everything that's going to come on later. You know, to have a secure substrate, well attached to the wall, not risk of anything falling off the ceiling, getting that secure first. Small areas of repairs to match what's existing can be made by skilled craftsmen. This is running a cornice molding with a wooden horse that's matched to the curves of it to get it in place. Then on a grander scale, the craftsmanship is still here in New York to replicate any possible level of ornament. Anything is possible with sculptors who can sculpt models, take molds from buildings, cast them, replicate, and then install pieces, either whole spaces or infill. Medallions can be great statement pieces in rooms. The scale of them for a room is really important. Size, dimensions, the pattern that complements other details in the space. And, you know, new ones can be designed for spaces as well when they're missing. And this is one of the services we provide and enjoy doing, where paint samples are taken, looked at under the microscope to develop a chromochronology, which is a fancy word for paint history, as well as understanding the materials. So if it's a space that actually had some lavish decoration, like glazes and metallic finishes and gilding, as well as paint alone, that can be understood and then correlated with physical clues in the building to help develop a whole picture of the color scheme over time. Samples and mock-ups we, you know, really encourage people to do, particularly because you want to look at the colors and textures in the lighting of the space day and night with the kinds of bulbs that you'll be using. Some ceilings really very elaborate. This is a lobby of a 1929 apartment building, fairly small lobby with beautiful travertine walls, where we did an investigation, and this was in Brooklyn, Grand Army Plaza era. On the left, large residential building, but there was information that it had been painted by a very good artist early in the century. Finding it requires using things like scalpels and different types of chemical strippers very carefully by conservators who know how to remove other layers without destroying what's underneath. Here we go, the end result. There are so many possibilities for conserving wood finishes, lots of kinds of materials. Sometimes you can do just a cleaning with mild materials and small touch-ups, especially if there are original finishes and sheens and varnishes that are attractive. Don't need to assume that everything would need to be stripped and refinished, because that can actually take away the quality of a patina of historic finishes that may be on there. This ceiling had a dropped ceiling under it, and then when that was removed, it turned out to have a faux bois finish, which is imitation wood done by decorative painters. And another example of faux bois, in this case the room had a really kind of dark overpainted actual wood, but it just wasn't the right color anymore. And it was actually fairly easy to repaint it in a lighter oak faux bois color that was chosen from samples to lighten up the space and still keep the faux bois, the wood finish intent that it had. Then there's the polychrome and stenciling that you see in some grander interiors, including residential interiors. We definitely come across them. And those are great candidates for sensitive conservation, very gentle cleaning, stabilization of the historic paint through adhesives, and in painting areas of loss, polychroming. Most people are aware that there are companies that make historic wallpapers, but it's actually not so difficult to have custom reproduction wall coverings with the technology. In the past, it used to be more laborious and costly to do small runs of wall covering, and now through digital technology, it's more accessible to make custom finishes. This residential lobby had a finishes investigation where it was found that the original colors were soft tones with glazed and gilded highlights to complement the existing constone. I do value the expertise of professionals who have been through the process before, who help kind of avoid costly mistakes and thinking through all the parts of a major project. Thinking about the overall space and its historic character, and how the details fit together, the flow between the rooms, and taking a lot of time for planning. Having a good scope of work in a project that's really well itemized with plans, drawings, sketches, having walkthroughs with your contractors so you really explain the expectations, having mock-ups so that they can see the level of workmanship you want to have at the end. All of these things will help you have a successful outcome. And then the mess of the project, we call it the dirty work phase and the clean phase. And the dirty work is cutting things and putting in wiring and plumbing and patching, the things that are dusty and dirty. So it comes down to, you know, scheduling and planning so the tasks are properly coordinated with the trades and you leave enough time for these things to be done in that order to then get to your end result, perfectly quality finishes, a clean space ready to furnish.